join 50 people and remove the gentleman to the other side of the street since the police have decided it's his right to stand here. If it was a Reverend Al Sharpton rally and we were white racists, it would not be permitted. But since they have a double standard, move the guy to the other side of the street.
I'm just saying.
I want 20 volunteers to approach the gentleman and help, or very strong female volunteers to help move this one individual across the street. Ladies and gentlemen, the Star Spangled Banner. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for coming. We are in a horrific situation in this country. We're on the verge of surrender to one of the most horrific regimes known in the world, a tyrannical regime to which the United States is prepared to deliver nuclear weapons. Now, we have seen raw political power utilized to try in every way to push this deal through. And there will be many truths which will be revealed today that will shock you even beyond the things that you already know. To begin with our speakers, we have to show the world, we have to show Senator Gillibrand, we have to show Senator Cory Booker, we have to show Congressman Nadler, we have to show them and others, and Debbie Wasserman Schultz and all the others, what will happen and what has happened when billions of dollars will go to the Iranian regime, the regime of the mullahs. They will not build hospitals and highways. They will kill and maim innocent people as they have done in the past. Our first speaker, Ken Stethem. Many of you will remember his brother during the Reagan era. Ken is a retired U.S. Navy SEAL, senior explosive ordnance disposal technician. In his 20-year military career, he served on SEAL teams 4 and 8, in addition to the U.S. Navy's most elite special operations organization known as the Navy Special Warfare Development Group. He has 30 years of experience in this area. Now, prior to his retirement from the military, he recognized that future military operations other than war will demand a new generation of intermediate force options to safely and effectively deal with aggressive non-combatants. To recall the case of his dear and beloved brother, please welcome Ken Stethem.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to be here. And thank each and every one of you for coming out this evening. I'm here tonight because I want to share a little bit about my background, a little bit about my brother, a little bit about my family. My brother was 23 years old when the hijacking of TWA flight 847 was taken to Beirut, Lebanon, and he was shot and killed. And people might think, well, that's a horrible thing and these things happen. But not a lot of people know what happened on that plane. And not a lot of people know that he was given a choice to yell into a mic so that the tower would send a fuel truck to refuel the plane and take off. He knew that, and he refused to scream, so they beat him. He refused to scream again, so they threatened to shoot him. And he looked a pistol, the barrel of the pistol in the eye, and the way the pilot said it, not a sound was heard to come from him. He sacrificed his life for his fellow teammates, his fellow passengers, his Navy, and his nation. His legacy is one of honor, courage, and commitment, and one that we're proud of. I come from a family, a very Navy family. Dad, mom, three brothers. We've got over 100 years in the Navy. We know what it means to serve. And our whole family knows what it means to sacrifice. We've seen terrorism personally, and we've seen it professionally. And I'm also here tonight to remember the other veterans, the soldiers, the sailors, the airmen, and the Marines, the other victims of terrorism, fathers, mothers, sons, daughters, brothers, sisters. They've lost their liberty, their limbs, their loved ones, and their lives. I want you all to remember these people, remember their sacrifice, remember their loss, as I go through and I share with you the issues that I have with what they call the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. Before I talk about the issues that I have with that, I'd like to share three things with you. First one, if you're going to do anything, whether it's record something on video, buy a car, buy a house, it doesn't matter. You think of it. There's only three ways you can do anything in this world: scientifically, non-scientifically, and pseudoscientifically. That's it. You can do it through research, analyzation, studies, premises, and proofs. Scientific. Or you can do it with just opinions or and prejudices, or you can do it pseudoscientifically, which is through agendas, flashy presentation, polysyllabic words, and sometimes jokes. Second thing I'd like you to remember, Einstein said, if you give me a problem in an hour, he said, I'll spend 55 minutes on the problem and 5 minutes on the solution. He's going to ask questions, good questions. And the other thing Einstein said that applies to this current debate is the world is a dangerous place, not because of evil men in it, but because good men and women do nothing. If Einstein said this, I believe it. So, the great debate. There's three issues that I have with the great debate. The first one is the principles. The second one is the process. And the third thing is the policies. The principles. It's real simple. It's never a good time to reward evil men, evil regimes, for evil acts. The thought that we have congressmen and women supporting a deal that rewards evil men for evil acts that have cost American lives is for me unthinkable. George Washington gave a caution in his farewell address. And in it he said, we need to be careful about how we become encumbered with other nations. We're becoming encumbered with a terrorist nation, and I don't support that. He also said, let us raise a standard that the wise and the just, the honest, can repair. This agreement and the things it does is not repairable. All they're going to do is talk and talk some more if the terms aren't met. It's never a good time to empower your enemy. It's never a good time to give ground to evil, especially at the expense of your veterans and victims of terrorism. The process, this SALT I, SALT II, START I, START II, they were treaties. They needed ratification from Congress. Congress had input. There was no congressional input in this. The process was flawed. And finally, the policy. We've been told with this joint cooperation plan of action that we need to separate terrorism from the nuclear deal. That's like trying to separate heat from a flame, and you cannot do it. We've been told that military options are still on the table. If that's true, what are they? Are the options nailed to the table? Are the military options going to be unilateral and immediate? Or are we going to build a coalition and talk about it? You know what? Nobody can answer that question because it's not clear. It's not defined in the plan of action. There's been 6 presidents, 10 administrations have passed. And Iran has gone from a small rogue group to a nuclear power. The time to stop them is now. The place to stop them is here. Please, everyone, call your family, call your friends, call your congressmen. Congressmen and women, do not support the enemy. This is a Paul Revere moment for our generation. Ride well.
Thank you, Ken. Ladies and gentlemen, let me give you a little bit of understanding why we're here. We have to let it all out. For 20 years, I worked in government, and during the time that I worked for Senator Al D'Amato, and you know where he would be on this deal, I don't have to tell you. Believe it or not, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand was our administrative assistant in the Washington office of Senator Al D'Amato. She has betrayed the legacy of Al D'Amato, and I'm going to tell you why. Because I know that she does not believe what she said when she was trying to explain lamely why she supports this dastardly agreement. And her counterpart, Senator Schumer, gave really, I must say, a very eloquent explanation of his reason for voting against the agreement. However, we do not want Senator Schumer to simply stand there. He should be taking the heroism of Senator Scoop Jackson to heart and rounding up the votes. But truthfully, it is Senator Gillibrand who has betrayed the American people and the citizens of the state of New York, because we know that she doesn't believe what she said, because any one of us who have read this agreement know it's an absurdity to think that it will do anything other than deliver a bomb to Iran for their nefarious uses and hundreds of millions in gas revenue and returned assets to fund terrorism. That's the truth. Now, we are deeply honored. Staff Sergeant Robert Bartlett, this man, on behalf of all of us, may God give him strength, was injured in combat by yet another Iranian bomb in 2005. Robert's head was cut in half from the left temple down through his jaw, and he would have shrapnel and third-degree burns to his face and hands. He lost his eye and teeth. His lung collapsed due to internal bleeding. There's no sense for me to detail every one of his injuries. Thank God this man is alive to come here and bear witness to Senator Gillibrand how outrageous it is that she is betraying people like Sergeant Bartlett. Please.
Thank you for hearing me today. I'm here to give you a voice of those who cannot be here. So please heed what I am saying. I joined the military at the age of 30 after I saw what happened on 9/11. I did my country service for you. I went to war for you. You sent me to war and I was glad to do it. I'm still here fighting for you. I gained nothing other than my country's freedom by being up here. Will you stand with me and hear what I have to say in the words of those who are not here because Iran killed them? In 2005, I was in Iraq. I would be hit by an Iranian bomb and die three times. By the grace of God, I was brought back by the great medical care and training of those who I served with. My buddy next to me wasn't so lucky or blessed. He went home to God. I had to speak for him and his kids who no longer have a father to raise them. Will you stand up for him? The reality is that the very man who killed Staff Sergeant Brooks and killed me is going to get billions of dollars. That's the reality. $150 billion equates to about $8 trillion of US dollars in equal revenue. Can you imagine if our military had $8 trillion? That's almost half of our debt. What could we do? Could we stop terrorism in its tracks? We'd have a chance at least. Maybe we could keep our military in uniform and not send them home like we're doing today. Guys I served with for 15 years don't even get a 20-year retirement because they are getting sent home early and budgets are getting cut. The world is on fire right now. Are you grabbing a bucket and supporting those who served and died for you? $150 billion can buy plenty of ICBMs. I can tell you that Israel is not in the threat of an ICBM. They don't need ICBMs to touch Israel. $100 million can buy one ICBM and a launch capable facility. $150 billion can buy how many of those? How many suicide vests can it buy? A suicide vest costs about $1,000. You can put it on your credit card. Are you standing with those who are wearing suicide vests and killing Americans? Are you calling your friends and family members? You have to do something. Stand with me. This is a time you can serve your country. You didn't get to wear the uniform, you're wearing it now. It's called an American flag. It's called being American. Stand with those who died for you. Stand with me and stand for America and stand side by side with Israel to stop terrorism and stand for peace for all mankind. Jew, Christian, Hindu, all face under one flag, all nations working together. God bless you, God bless America, and God bless you and your families.
Ladies and gentlemen, what can any of us say to that? What kind of sacrifice is that for all of us? How can any congressman or senator not be ashamed to present funding and the means for a nuclear bomb through a surrender agreement in the face of such sacrifice? I want to call your attention for a moment. There's a reason these gay pride flags are here. You know why? Because we are a people, as Americans, of live and let live. We are not barbarians. President Obama, what do you think they do with gay people in Iran? They hang them from a crane. They hang them from a crane. They should hang these people across the street on a crane too, by the way. I want to recognize, by the way, we'll hear, hopefully we'll get a chance to hear from Assemblyman Dolph Hyken, another hero who has personally sacrificed through great inconvenience to bring this issue to the fore, and council member of Nassau County, Bruce Blakeman. But now I want to welcome two wonderful people, my friend Sari Singer, and would you please come up with Daniil? Sari herself, by the way, is a survivor of a bus bombing in Jerusalem, funded by Secretary of State Kerry's favorite nation, Iran. And so is Daniil Miller. He's here with us. He is also a victim of an Iranian-financed terror attack by Hamas in Jerusalem. And he then sued the Islamic Republic of Iran in United States courts. Please welcome Daniil Miller.
We are here today at an historical moment. We are going to look back years from now at this moment, at this time that the world became infinitely more dangerous. It is a time when we gave the largest state sponsor of terrorism the ultimate power, legitimacy. My name is Daniil Miller, and I am one of many victims of that terrorism. Let me take you back to September 4th, 1997. I had just graduated high school, and like all of my friends, was attending a year of college abroad in Jerusalem. On the first day I arrived, I was enjoying lunch with two of my friends at the crowded pedestrian mall Ben Yehuda in Jerusalem, when three suicide bombers carrying briefcases full of rusty shrapnel soaked in arsenic exploded only a few feet away from me. They killed five innocent victims that day, including three 14-year-old girls, and injured over 180, including an eight-month-old baby. I am standing on the podium today with another victim of Iran-sponsored terrorism, Sari Singer, who was also injured in a bus bombing in Jerusalem. I was one of the lucky ones that day. But when you're sandwiched between three suicide bombers intent on killing you, luck takes on a whole new meaning. I have permanent nerve damage in both my arm and leg that affect routine physical activity to this very day. The image of me staring into the eyes of one of the bombers as I heard him mutter Allahu Akbar and explode right in front of my face is an image I will never forget. I live with the effect to this very day. I would be remiss if I didn't mention the ones who could not be here on this stage today, including the over 240 U.S. Marines who were brutally murdered by Iran at the Marine Barracks in 1983. But I'm not only here today to remind you of the past, but I'm here to warn you of the treacherous future. I'm here for the mother, for the son who has not yet lost his mother, for the wife who has not yet lost her spouse, and for the child who has not yet lost to her parent. The supporters of the Iranian deal will tell you that this deal is not about terrorism, that it is about preventing Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon. Well, let's put aside the terrifying fact that it does not even accomplish that. Instead, it guarantees it. But you cannot make a deal with Iran and ignore terrorism. You cannot tell me with any integrity that the $150 billion that you are handing back to the biggest sponsor of terrorism will go towards building roads and museums. I know, you know, Senator Gillibrand and all the supporters of the deal know exactly where that money is going to go. It is going to go back into the hands of terrorist organizations that have pledged to annihilate both Israel and the United States. We cannot allow the United States, the country we love so much, to enter into a deal that will legitimize terrorists, that will pave the road for them to have a nuclear weapon, and will endanger the lives of U.S. citizens here and around the world. I applaud all the members of Congress, Senator Schumer, Senator Menendez, and all of the supporters who have already stood up and opposed this deal. But more needs to be done. You need to lobby your members of Congress and your colleagues and explain to them and educate them as to why this is such an historically tragic deal. I urge Senator Gillibrand and all of the supporters of this deal to reconsider their decision. For the sake of their children, for the sake of all of the children around the world, do it for the memory of Yael Batwin, Sivan Zakar, and Smadar Al-Hanan, three 14-year-olds who were just buying school supplies during their first week of school. Uri Kushalevi, who at 20 years old was standing in a store on Ben Yehuda trying to support his family and came to the aid of a strange woman who was being assaulted by the suicide bomber and stood in between them and saved her life and many more. And Yehuda Markovitz of Jerusalem. They no longer have a voice. They are the five heroes who died 18 years ago on the streets of Ben Yehuda, only 5 feet away from me. We need to be their voice. You need to be their voice and reject this deal. Thank you.
We have two unbelievable guys, two great radio hosts, and they've got to be broadcasting for our cause and for other good causes. So we're going to welcome them both up, and they're each going to speak to you, and then we're going to have something really, really special for all of you. We hope the case will be made that the conscience of these Congress members and senators will be awakened, who they are sacrificing on the altar of a false peace, which has reminiscences of 1938. Please welcome Mike Gallagher of 970 The Answer and David Webb.
So this is what freedom looks like, huh? This is what a free country looks like. You know, it's one of the oldest maxims of war and statecraft. Dates back to the 4th century BC. It goes something like this, in almost all languages. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. The premise is simple. Two opposing parties can or should work together when necessary to defeat a common enemy, right? We used it to great effect in World War II, partnering with Stalin and the Soviet Union to defeat Hitler. Well, in 2015, President Obama has invented a new maxim in his approach with Iran. The enemy of my friend is my friend. President Obama says Israel is a friend. If he means what he says, then he is actually taking that old maxim, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, and turning it upside down. We know what's going on. President Obama is a deep thinker. He went to Harvard Law School, where they learn how to stand life itself on its head every day for 4 years. He actually believes that calling people friends and treating them as enemies, and calling people enemies and treating them as friends, can actually change the moral universe. In no other place but the White House and the State Department does that maxim make any sense. The fact is, we are dealing with people who are desperately trying to advance a deal that lifts sanctions from Iran while working hard around the world to impose sanctions on Israel through the BDS movement. Let's sum up the logic of our president's Harvard-trained mind. John Kerry was Yale-trained, so perhaps I broaden to Ivy League. Let's sum up the deal. Our government has decided to release $150 billion that it well knows will be used to fund Iran and its terrorist surrogates. And it has done this in the name of making the Middle East safer. It'd be like giving Los Angeles, letting them give the Bloods and the Crips hordes of cash in hopes that maybe they won't feel the need to sell drugs anymore. Maybe they'll build some middle-class home in Glendale and invest in a local Jamba Juice franchise. Only this administration could conjure up such an idea. The idea that you might need to destroy the Middle East in order to save it. And make no mistake about it, Iran will not stop until it gets the bomb. And under the inspection part of this deal, which is largely a self-reporting regime, there's nothing stopping them. Indeed, the lifting of the sanctions is a down payment for that bomb. Heck, maybe we should get into the financing of this deal too. Do a 10-year note with one of those 1.9% loans. Maybe the Federal Reserve can make it a zero interest loan. They've been giving away money for 8 years. Why stop it just inflating US assets in the stock market? I hope you consider this when you consider the prospect of Team Obama-Kerry as negotiators. When asked why we didn't negotiate a deal for the hostages, at least, the media was told that it was, get this, a separate issue. A separate issue? As Charles Krauthammer pointed out, Iran will get everything it wanted out of this deal. Their issues were all addressed. Iran, he said, will be flush with cash, legitimized as a normal international actor in good standing, recognized, as Obama once said, as a very successful regional power. What did we get? Nothing. Not even our hostages. Iran will be emboldened. They'll continue to arm Hezbollah. They may just end up ruling Iraq. That is, if they can beat down the JV squad President Obama once called ISIS. Iran will become the preeminent Middle East power. Iran's leaders who call for death to Jews and death to America mean what they say and say what they mean. Do any of these Ivy Leaguers see that language, at the very least, as a microaggression? The truth is, Iran's leaders are not kidding when they say these words. This deal will put us all in danger. When President Reagan said, tear down this wall, he had two audiences. The Russian people, particularly the dissidents, and the leftist peaceniks here at home, some of whom were in the evangelical world, who were toying with nuclear disarmament. He gave a clear and forceful speech to both. President Reagan called the Soviet Union what it was, an evil empire. Wouldn't it be breathtaking to have such clarity in the White House once again? Thank you for your voice. Thank you for being here. God bless you, and God bless America. And now, my colleague, Sirius XM host, and great American, David Webb.
Tea Party 365, baby!
Yeah, there's an old Tea Party guy in the crowd. First of all, it's my pleasure to go in few minutes, you'll hear from Senator Joe Lieberman and Senator Lindsay Graham. But first, I want Senator Gillibrand, New York, and the world to hear you. So how loud can you be? Let me hear you. Louder, louder. This is supposed to be a rally. You've got to be heard. Senator Gillibrand, America will not surrender. Israel will not surrender. We will not surrender because of our value for life. If Islamic rule and the Islamic State of Iran is so attractive, then why are refugees from the Middle East headed east, not headed east towards Mecca or Medina, or Baghdad, or Sana'a, or any other location? Why are they headed west? It's simple. I'll give you the answer. American values, Western values, shaped by ancient Hellenic values. Freedom of the press, freedom to vote, freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of movement, freedom of change, freedom of trade, independent judicial systems of the people, by the people, for the people, under constitutions, for the people. That is what is at stake. Make no doubt, and think about the Magna Carta, a charter of liberties, and where we are as a Western world. All the countries that adopted these values, these ancient Western Hellenic values, we have thrived. We have dominance in technology, in wealth, in military, in diplomatic power, in health. We have thrived. Those others, like many, like Iran, they have theocracies, poverty, corruption, death, and they preach destruction. So why would we want them to be the hegemon in the Middle East? Why would we want a nuclear hegemon and a nuclear arms race in the Middle East by allowing Iran to have nuclear capability? That is why, my friends, without Israel to stand against them, the Middle East, a vast part of it, remains a darkness for the human race. And if it wasn't for oil, the Middle East would be worse off than sub-Saharan Africa. Think about that for a moment. think about the clash of civilizations, the clash of culture, and what that means, and why we must stick up for America, for Israel, for freedom, for Western values, for true life and value of life. Why would we want to allow them to have nuclear capability? I'll leave you with that question, but I want you to bring these two men up in your loudest voice for Senator Gillibrand. Let me hear you, New York. Let me hear you, all of you in front of me, for the cameras, for the media. Turn them around if you want. I want to hear from you. Senator Gillibrand, we will not surrender America. Do not surrender America. Do not surrender. Let me hear you. Do not surrender. 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 Louder. Come on, let me hear you. Surrender. Louder. 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 Do not surrender. All right. Now, I can't tell you how much I respect these two gentlemen. They have stood up on this issue. Senator Joe Lieberman, Senator Lindsey Graham. Jeffrey, take it away.
Thank you, David. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we're here to welcome three of the greatest heroes in America. Now, let me just tell you, this is unprecedented. It is not meant in any disrespect. We know the protocol of the Senate. I believe this has never happened before in front of the offices of two other senators. But Senator Schumer has given us his vote. We'd like him to do more. But we're here. We chose this site because Senator Gillibrand has not thought carefully enough about Sergeant Bartlett, Bob Stethem, and so many others. Welcome a great United States Senator, one of the greatest experts on foreign policy and national security, Senator Lindsey Graham.
Thank you all very much. I am not from New York. I'm a Southern Baptist. We're all in this together. We're Americans, and the Ayatollah hates everybody here. So when I grow up, I want to be like Joe Lieberman. When it comes to party versus the country, you pick the country. Thank you, Joe. When it comes to Israel, you're uncompromising. Thank you, Joe. As to this deal, President Obama said the crazies will vote no. Let me tell you, you're crazy if you vote yes. You're crazy to give the Ayatollah $100 billion. He's not going to build roads and bridges and schools. You might as well write the check to Hezbollah. You're crazy to give him a pathway to a bomb. You're crazy to give him a missile to deliver it. And you need to understand who he is. He is a religious Nazi. He wants a master religion, not a master race. He would kill everybody here if he could. When he says death to Israel, he literally means it. When he says death to America, he wants to accomplish it. I am in charge of all the funding for the United Nations in the United States Senate. To our friends at the International Atomic Energy Association, you will not get a penny until you give us that agreement. No secret deals. You would be crazy to vote on a deal when you don't know what's in it. You'd be crazy to let the Iranians inspect themselves. You would be crazy to give them a pathway to a bomb knowing who they are. And let me say this, if they will kill their own kids, what do you think they'll do to yours? So the marriage from hell is about to occur. A radical Islamic regime with a weapon of mass destruction. We're going to stop it over time. Don't quit. We're going to have more votes. This is not over. I will introduce sanctions on Iran until they stop sponsoring terrorism.
You want to take a picture?
I will cut off every penny to the UN until they let us look at this deal.
No, with them.
Okay, and if you think it's such a good deal, why do you tell Israel we'll give you more weapons? If it's such a good deal, why does Israel need more weapons? I'm here to tell you that I appreciate you being here tonight. Are you glad you're here? When they write the history of our times, you will have spoken up. This is the biggest miscalculation since Munich. We're about to empower the most radical Islamic regime on the planet with more money to kill Americans and to wreak havoc on the region, and one day to create the second Holocaust. Here's my promise. Never again. Never again will we sit on the sidelines and watch another 9/11 occur without fighting back. This is the 76th anniversary of the German invasion of Poland. Have we learned nothing from history? Don't give up. Fight back. We need your voice. Ladies and gentlemen, you are here when it matters. I have been with you the whole way. We will walk together. Republicans and Democrats, black, white, libertarians and vegetarians, we're going to fight back against radical Islam. We're going to do what we did not do in the 30s. We're going to stand up, and we're going to get it right this time. God bless you all. And to my, I thought being a Baptist was hard until I met an Orthodox Jewish person named Joe Lieberman. To my Orthodox friends, too many rules. To Joe Lieberman, you make me proud to call you my friend. Ladies and gentlemen, Joe Lieberman, the defender of Israel. Yay!
Thank you, Lindsey Graham. I'm going to tell you what you already know. In the United States Senate, there is not today a more fervent, informed, effective opponent of this terrible deal with Iran or a better, more steadfast supporter of the State of Israel than Lindsey Graham of South Carolina. And before I forget, may I say, as Lindsey often says in South Carolina, Shana Tova and a good Gebench Dior. That means Happy New Year. Okay. Look, thank you to Jeff. Thank you to every one of you who came out here on a late summer afternoon to serve a cause larger than yourselves, which is the cause of American security and world security in opposition to the worst agreement that's been negotiated diplomatically in the history of the United States of America. We've got to stop it, and we can stop it. I want to start by thanking Chuck Schumer for having the courage and the principle to oppose this agreement from the get-go. That's the major reason why we still have a shot at getting enough votes to override an Obama veto. And I also want to say, as a lifelong Democrat, kicked out of the party in Connecticut for a while and I came back as an independent, but as a lifelong Democrat, what's happened to the Democratic Party of John F. Kennedy that I joined and signed up for a long time ago? That party that believed you could be a progressive on social issues and follow a strong and muscular foreign policy. Remember, Kennedy in his inaugural said that we will support any friend and oppose any foe to guarantee the survival and success of liberty. This agreement, which it pains me to say, Democrat after Democrat in the Senate have been endorsing, this agreement does the opposite. It supports our foes and opposes our friends. And I know the Obama administration says that's because they think this agreement will change Iran. Are their ears open? Are their eyes open? We have people here who have lost blood, lost friends, lost relatives because of Iranian-backed terrorism against Americans and others. Beirut, Khobar Towers, Iraq, Syria, you name it. They've been there and they have our blood on their hands. The second thing to say is, listen to them, listen to the Iranians, since The agreement was signed in the middle of July. They still say at the highest level, they're going to continue to support terrorism. They're going to annihilate Israel and death to America. And Ayatollah Khamenei gets up there and prays to Almighty God that he answer their prayers, death to America. How can you make an agreement with a country that wants to kill you? How can you make an agreement with a country that wants to kill you? Pretty hard. Maybe only if it's airtight. And this agreement is full of holes. You know it all. 24 days minimum to get inspections. Later, the secret agreement, we find out, allows them to self-inspect at Parchin. Lindsay and I worked hard on economic sanctions. And the whole aim of the economic sanctions was to bring Iran to the negotiating table to make a simple deal. We end the economic sanctions on Iran in return for them ending their nuclear weapons program. What is in this deal before Congress now? We end our economic sanctions on Iran, they get a legitimate legalized path to nuclear weapons. How could anyone reasonably support such an agreement? So I thank Senator Schumer. I wanted to say to my former colleague and my friend Kirsten Gillibrand, who I respect, I like, I was deeply disappointed. I was shocked. I was amazed when she came out in support of this agreement. I know it's unlikely, but I want to appeal to Senator Gillibrand. Look inside your heart. Look inside your head. Look at facts that have come out about this agreement since you declared you were for it, particularly the secret side agreement and the self-inspection at Parchin, and do what is reasonable and courageous and change your vote. Change your vote. Stand up for America. Stand up for America's friends in the world. Change your vote. Amen.
Change your vote. Change your vote.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. I think we know that right now, the odds of us having enough votes to override an Obama veto are not as great as they were a few weeks ago. We still mathematically could do it. But between now and the vote, anything could happen. We could discover another secret side agreement. The Iranian leadership could say things that are even more outrageous and hateful and anti-American and anti-Israel and pro-terrorist than they've done already. But I want to echo what Lindsay said, and I want to, always good at a time like this to remember Churchill. Churchill said at one point, this is not the beginning of the end. It is the end of the beginning. This deal, even if it makes its way through Congress, which would be horrific, it's only the end of the beginning. There's a lot more ahead with people like Lindsey Graham in Congress to fight for freedom, to fight for security, to fight for Israel. And the second thing that Churchill said at one of the darker moments of World War II was to the people of England, never, never, never give up. Are we going to give up?
No!
You bet your life we're not, and neither am I, and that's why eventually we will stop Iran from becoming a nuclear power. Thank you. God bless you. I am glad. Well, I'm going to give it back to Jeff.
I want you all to note what Joe Lieberman said. Senator Joe Lieberman, this is in the spirit of Daniel Patrick Moynihan, in the spirit of Senator Scoop Jackson, in the spirit of Frank Church. Those voices are gone, and it's very sad. And I also want you to know that the idea of this bipartisan appeal to Senator Gillibrand came from our dear friend, and give him a New York cheer, Senator Lindsey Graham, because it was his idea, and that's why we're all here.
Yay!
And now I'm pleased to welcome the third member of the Troika, and then we have another guest from a little up north from here. But the third member of the Troika, consisting also of Senator Graham and Senator Lieberman, a great American public servant. He was for many years the head of the intelligence community. He was the head of the Central Intelligence Agency. He served under two or three presidents. Oh my God, four presidents. And yes, he's a registered Democrat. Please welcome the Honorable James R. Woolsey.
Yay!
Thank you. I was deeply honored to be asked to be here today with two old friends, Lindsay and Joe, and the promising upcoming Bob Astorino. But on the other hand, since I spent 22 years as a Washington lawyer, and then some time out at the CIA, I'm actually honored to be invited into any polite company for any purpose at all. I think it's extremely important to focus on the fact that we are not trying to establish an agreement or a way of working on nuclear power with a rational, reasonable state. If this negotiation were with Denmark, we would not all be standing here. You can trust the Danes and quite a few other countries to do what they say when they sign a treaty or a formal agreement. That is not only not the rule for the Revolutionary Guards and for the powers that be in Iran, it's not only not the rule, they make fun of it. Tahiya is the word. Tricking infidels. It's recommended, it's not just permitted. So we have a situation where we are trying to put together a structure that, as Joe said, would let there be a renunciation of nuclear power on the part of the Iranians and a backing down on some of the sanctions by the Americans and the West. That is not happening. That is not close to happening. There is no mitigation at all of what is taking place. We have in the Iranian government ruled by theocratic, totalitarian, genocidal imperialists. And that is not just four expletives, it's an accurate description of this government. Theocratic, absolutely. Totalitarian, remember all the young people who were massacred back in 09 when they tried to demonstrate in the streets of Tehran on behalf of a real election? It is clear where they stand on the issue of other religions and peoples, and especially the Jewish people. What part of death to America and death to Israel don't they understand? Totalitarian, genocidal, and imperialists. They control major shares of Lebanon, of Iraq, of Yemen, of increasing portions of the Middle East. They are a growing empire, and they don't want you to mess with it. What we have to do is stop that. We have to stop the growth of their power. We have to deny them any nuclear processes, not just nuclear weapons, but any nuclear industrial activity at all. We have to stop their even talking about genocide, much less practicing it. And we have to stop their imperial designs on the rest of the Middle East. This is a huge job. This country, however, has done harder things. It's done more things. It won World War I. It won World War II. It won the Cold War. We can do this. But we have to stand firm. We have to know that we can do it. We have to believe in ourselves. And we have to tell the mullahs to go peddle their papers. They are not needed or wanted anymore.
as our senators leave. Let's give them a round of applause. They came special here for this, especially Senator Lindsey Graham. What a friend from South Carolina all the way to New York. Ladies and gentlemen, so I told you I would tell you a little bit more. You know, there's someone in the audience, I don't want to embarrass him with his last name, Larry. Larry knew Jerry Nadler in the early 1980s. Do you know that Congressman Jerry Nadler in the early 1980s, he was a conservative and a hawk on defense. But to please his left-wing constituency, he's now betrayed us. Isn't that a shame? How outrageous is that? And by the way, many of you may know from the advertisements that we were to have had State Senator Jesse Hamilton of Brooklyn, a Democrat. Well, Reverend Al Sharpton made sure he's not here. So, the President of the United States, can you imagine? He has Reverend Al Sharpton helping him with foreign policy. How low has this country come? How low? But now I want to welcome someone that should please us. Please welcome the County Executive of Westchester, Rob Astorino.
What kind of upside-down world are we living in today where the President of the United States considers our allies to be Iran and Cuba and our enemy to be Israel? What kind of world are we living in, folks? You know, we were here in New York the victims of the worst terrorist attack in our country's history, just a few miles south, and we're going to commemorate that event on September 11th, happened just 14 short years ago, and yet our so-called leaders in Washington, D.C., including our senator from New York, has forgotten what we have gone through as New Yorkers and as a nation. And President Obama is asking us to take Iran at their word. Well, I agree with him. And their words are death to America and death to Israel. So why, in this world of ours, would we sign an agreement that trusts Iran, the number one state-sponsored terrorist group and country in the world, to uphold their end of the bargain? I applaud Senator Graham and Senator Lieberman and CIA Director Woolsey for being here today. I applaud Senator Schumer for being courageous in voting no. But Senator Schumer has to go beyond just voting no. He has to convince Senator Gillibrand to vote no too. There should be no winks and nods. There should be no party favorites here. This is about national security. This is about protecting New York and protecting America and protecting our closest friend in the Middle East, Israel. It is not about party politics. It is not about loyalty to a president. It is about loyalty to the United States of America. This deal must be voted down to protect Americans. President Reagan said the foreign policy of America was then, and it was proven right, peace through strength, trust but verify. We now have a deal that is peace through weakness and trusts without verification. This must be voted down. Tell Senator Gillibrand to change her vote. Tell Congressman Nadler to change his vote. Country before party. God bless you for being here. Thank you so very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, to further illustrate how shameful Senator Gillibrand's vote is, you should all know that it's going to come out how close we were in 2009 to seeing the regime in Iran collapse. We had the opportunity. Why do you think we have the Clandestine Services Division of the Central Intelligence Agency? It's to send aid to people like those who were bloodied in the streets by the mullahs. That regime was close to collapsing, and we helped them.